meeting of the Northampton Public Shade Tree Commission, September 16th, 2015. I think we're all here with the exception of Todd, who is somewhere on the Mediterranean.
Wow.
Good place to be with the bad news that was on the headlines yesterday in the paper about council down there. Anyway, okay, so this is normally our public comment period, and there are no members of the public to make comments. So I'm going to move on to approval of minutes, and you all should have two sets of minutes, one that I sent right after the last meeting, and one that I sent today. Sorry about that late arrival, and then Terry's working on the final set of last week's minutes?
Yep.
Okay, so we're nearly there. And then we're all cut up. Hey, Mara, good to see you.
What are the dates of the minutes that we're going to approve today?
Today, we're going to approve,
The
5th and the 19th.
August.
And, let's start with the 5th, okay? I think there was only one. Does anyone have any amendments they'd like to suggest to the August 5th minutes?
Oh, the only thing, my name keeps getting spelled wrong and everything. It's W-E-R. I kind of let go and I was like, all right, it's happening, so.
I don't have originated that.
It's okay.
Okay, so correction, Jen's name, W-E-R-N-E-R.
My apologies.
No, that's quite right. Sorry, happens a lot.
Oh, just a spelling, a minor spelling thing, Terry. Page 3 of the minutes of August 5th. Rob Postal makes a motion to accept ACCEPT. Otherwise, I don't have any changes to suggest. Anyone else? Otherwise, can we have a motion to accept the minutes?
I'll pass the council.
I move to accept the minutes of August 5th.
Okay, do we have a second?
We got to keep the reading today.
Well, Mira's not a member of the commission.
Oh, I thought, no.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, these are accepted as amended. And now the August 19th minutes.
Can I ask a question about these?
Sure.
What was the outcome of the letter?
Can we address that on your tree ward report?
Yes, it's one of my things, yeah.
Okay. Do you have a motion to accept the minutes? I don't have any suggestions. Okay. Jay makes a motion. Andrew, do you see that as a second? All in favor? Okay. Brief chair report. Marilyn set up a to-do list that is a Google sheet that everyone access. Does everyone have access to that, and has everyone gone there?
Yeah.
Is that working for folks?
Yeah.
Okay, that sounds great. So I'm going to give you a moment during the meeting to Marilyn, now as a matter of course, is going to be listening through the meeting for to-do items, and at the end of the meeting is going to summarize what they are and we'll put them on there.
Yeah.
what?
The spreadsheet.
The idea, the spreadsheet?
Who sent it?
I think Marilyn sent it.
I sent it out the day after our last meeting, so that would have been the 30th. No, sorry, September 30th. And then Lily, you sent out something.
I may have sent a reminder link or something.
Okay.
Yeah, you did.
But it's the same thing, it's the same document. Just want to remind people that we want to be careful with this one because it's a shared document in which we're updating it in between meetings. So we want to make sure that we don't have any kind of commentary on it. And we're just treating it as like a purely administrative thing. We're putting when we got something done. I actually added a column to it, which is deadline.
Okay.
Not everything's going to have a deadline, but to the extent that we can, I'd like to assign deadlines to tasks.
Okay.
All right. Status of the search. Yeah.
I've been updating dates on that. Some of them are open-ended, so I just have left it open-ended.
Okay.
Should we have a place where we can tell who's up? Does it let you know who's updating it as we go?
Well, you know, with Google Sheets, you can always look at the history, but it's a clunky way of seeing who's updated it. So not really, Jay.
That thought came to me as I was doing it. We need to keep track of who's updated. I guess whoever name it is would be updated.
Yeah, you know what we could do is we could put a column, like if you make a change. Like, for example, I think I added two things to it. I added something about the tree nursery. And I can't remember something, about the grant application. We can put a column saying added by, just so you all can know who put that new thing in. Would that be helpful? Is that?
I don't know if that would create issues in the future.
Well, as the spreadsheet gets longer and longer, I think that would be a good historical thing to know.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anyone's adding things other than me, really, because I'm sort of, you know, the hub that's keep thinking about everyone's to-dos, or someone for their own purposes are adding their own methods. So, I assume it's from me, unless you wrote it yourself.
Okay.
All right? Okay, so that's the to-do thing. And then I just wanted to talk about the SurveyMonkey. According to the deadline we originally gave, we're going to close it in 2 days, but a common strategy is to give people like a bonus week or something to finish it, or even just 48 hours. Oh, these came in, these are hard copies.
Okay.
At the DPW?
Yes.
Okay, great.
What are the numbers like so far?
So we've gotten about 275 responses. It's good. I think we can do better. And I think that if we put out a final push to all of the same places we originally put them out, we could easily double that. Or at least get to like 400, which I think is reasonable. Is everyone okay with me putting out we're going to do one more week? I don't see any downside to it.
Yeah, it's not like the comments are valid, it's complete.
Yeah. And actually, there's really no such thing as late at this point, because there's nothing time-sensitive.
So that would close on the 25th instead of the 18th?
Sure.
Yeah.
And then, it's going to take a lot of sorting through the data, because they're not, a lot of them are not quantitative, with the exception of the ranking. It's really, in written form, in text form. Some really interesting information. And I think you guys are going to be pleased just by all the ideas that are coming forward.
Very
college
students.
There is, I do have a remote possibilities. There's a AP statistics class that's offered at Northampton High. And, you know, the teacher may be willing to take it on as a project.
You know, it would be great to migrate the stuff in a form where we're easily searchable by keyword. You know, we have only got this thing for 1 month, and then we're going to have to keep paying for it. So I'd love to just like migrate everything into like a CSV form file or something like that. And then, but then, yeah, I mean, then it's possible that folks could crunch it, but it's not going to be, they're not going to be able to run statistical, you know, analysis, because I, as I said, it's more qualitative. On the other hand, they could make it easier for us by sorting by some of that qualitative stuff by keywords. Okay, anyway, I just want to give you that quick update. And then outcome of the tour, so we had a tree tour. Jay, who was it? Jay Todd, he would be, went out like 10 days ago and hit some of the big gateways in town and a little bit of downtown and identified probably like 165 spots where we could plant trees. And that was just in a less than 2 hour period in a very narrow geographical zone. So there's a lot of sites out there. And one thing that related to that, when we apply for our tree inventory grant or when we hire someone, I would so like that person to also capture potential planting sites. If we can ask for that.
Yeah, if we did that in spring when we were out collecting data, that was one of the categories.
Because they're out there on the street looking, right? I mean, we might as well have them just sort of pop in. Okay, and then from that, you know, I put all that on a spreadsheet, gave it to Rich, classified it as, you know, small, medium, or large potential trees at various sites. And we can talk later on with the fall planting subject about what's next in prioritizing the sites, but I thought that was a successful start.
What areas did you hit?
Bridge Street, and then we swung up to
North Street,
Industrial Drive.
Bates Street.
Bates Avenue. Right. So that's being because of school around there.
And then South, and went to the South. And actually went to down Crafts Avenue, went to South Street.
Yeah.
To the South.
Yeah, we had hoped to get to. Right. And we had hoped to get to Elm Street. We just didn't. So, in other words, a very, very small segment of the city. Okay, and then the last thing on my chair report is just that I want to see show of hands of folks who might be able to attend the September 28th Climate Change Adaptation Meeting. Okay, there's two parts of it. It's coming up Monday, and there's two parts of it. So there is a focus group happening that afternoon, and Wayne said that he would be happy to have one or two of us, but that he wanted that focus group to be a diverse body.
I have signed up.
You signed up for the focus group? Great. Okay. Has anyone else signed up for the focus group?
I wish I were going to be in town. I'm going to be at a climate training with Al Gore in my head. So I'll be doing something climate related.
Okay, great. Okay, well, Jay, I might join. Okay. And then
I don't think I can come
that night. That evening, it's at 7 o'clock.
What's the date?
September 28th, Monday, September 28th.
I might be in for a meeting.
For what?
For Sunnyside's, it's the mandatory
age. How is it for people?
Yeah.
I hear you. Okay, anyone else? Jay, are you just going to try to go to the daytime one and not the evening?
No, I'm going to go to the focus.
You're going to go to the
focus? I'm going to go to the focus.
All right, looks like it's you and me, Jay. What about you, Rich? You plan to go?
I don't think I'm going to be able to go. That's one thing. I'm not sure yet. Taking a week by week. Yeah. I have it in my book to go, but I'm not sure.
All right.
So is that the end of the chair update?
Yeah, that's the end of my chair update.
So regarding Spring Street, how did that go with the letter for when? $10,500 for buying those levity in Spring Street. How does that usually work out?
We take things up.
Oh,
is that?
Yeah, there is going to be a tree warden report. before.
Okay.
But you know what? Here's the thing, is that Chris Mason is not able to come today. He's next on the agenda. He emailed me yesterday saying I have a horrible toothache and I gotta go see the dentist.
Oh.
And I said, okay. So, for all intents and purposes, proceed with your question.
Okay.
It's in order.
Yeah, I'm just curious how that goes, what the process is. Do you have to take it to court? You know, is it like a non-criminal disposition thing?
Right now, the attorney Seawald has actually submitted a letter of demand to the attorney representing the defendant, I guess you could say, at this point. Yes, the defendant is the plaintiff. So we have received one letter in return with a ridiculous offer. Opposite end of the spectrum without giving away too much. And so I told the principal, well, absolutely not. The man stands at $9,500. So we have got another letter at the end of last week that was forwarded to me today. And they have upped their ante a little bit, but not anywhere near where I think it's worthwhile to settle in for. So, and if the owner of 191 Spring Street does not want to pay the demand, then we want to take the car. Hopefully we don't have to.
Very briefly, they cut down some trees or something?
Yeah, there's a whole bunch of, there's other issues that go on this as well. He ended up cutting down about 16 trees that were in the public right away. There were city trees. The gentleman had a bona fide driveway permit and a bona fide trench permit, which you get from the Department of Public Works. But those permits have to be executed prior to actually working in the city right away. So whether, even if there were no trees involved, the gentleman still violated city ordinance by working in the public right away without having his permit signed off. Both permits, actually. And then on top of it, he cut the trees down. So in my mind, the individual was very well aware of that he was working in the public right away. He's claiming that he did not know that he was working in the public right away. But clearly he was, so I think that the matter of fact, it's funny, the letter today said the gentleman is willing to give X amount of dollars, plus he also wants to participate in the volunteer tree planting to mitigate as public service. So I
that'd be a lot of hours of service.
Well, I sent a letter back that the man stands at $9,500. So the email back saying that the man stands at $9,500, so we'll just leave it at that. The attorney see will take care of it, so we'll see.
And that goes to the general fund? Or is it?
That will go to whatever that is. Susan Wright and I have not connected again with the tree fund that we want to start, the revolving account. We're trying to investigate what type of city funds we can use, where we can draw funds out of it without having to go in front of city council, and I have not connected with her. But typically it would be a revolving fund.
Mm-hmm.
It could be a general fund account, but the problem with that is what happens is that when you deposit money in the general fund, it typically goes into free cash.
See, that's the problem that I see with fines in general. It's a separate topic. You know, if this is a fine, and I'm sure Alan knows more than I do, but it has to go to the general fund. Unless there's like an agreement that they, you know, when they can receive it, they roll it over to another account. But
don't know the answer to that question. Find that
you
out.
Mean as a matter of Massachusetts law?
Yeah.
Huh.
Like
because
fines usually go to general fund.
Huh. Okay, well then maybe the word fine needs to be looked at. Because I know that Amherst, they definitely have that $90 per inch when a tree is removed. Even if it's removed, you know, like illegally, it goes into a dedicated tree planting fund.
So I think that's the ideal scenario. I guess my concern, and I'm sure it can be solved because there's a lot of smart people, you know, that it just doesn't go into tree planting.
I think that's the goal. I don't think it's going to go to the general fund. It could also be considered restitution.
Yeah.
And a restitution is allowed to go to specified accounts. So if we have someone that damages knocks over a street sign and they want to make restitution versus, or we can't, typically what we end up doing is someone damages city property, we actually have a company that goes after them and they go after their insurance company. We kind of stay out of it. So it's between the insurance company and the company that we hire. And usually they will eventually settle in some shape or form, whether it's the actual work is completed and the other party's insurance company doesn't work, or the person will actually provide restitution to the city and that money goes directly into the account the forced labor account and the OM account that we had to replace the materials with.
And Rich, is this for like if a car hits a tree kind of thing? What would that be for?
That would be for anything, any kind of person, any kind of person or persons that impacts city property.
Oh, okay.
So it could be a tree, it could be a sign.
I see, okay.
A problem that happened over on Elm Street in front of Cutter Ziskin is the police officer directed the truck into the tree. So they had a lane change last year, so half the tree got severed.
Indeed.
Last summer during the construction period, that's a different subject, but that's, you know.
Yeah.
Don't have any, because I tried to get restitution out of the trucking company, but it didn't go as well. So it isn't process. It's just basically, I would say, permit negotiations at this point. Sending letters back and forth. But the gentleman wants to build his house and he can't obtain a building permit until I sign off on the driveway permit.
I think that's an example of the system that's working very well. That's good. That's very good.
Yeah, it is nice to have some leverage.
Yeah, it's nice to have leverage and it's, you know, just wish the gentleman had just taken a few extra steps to just wait until I got there.
Yeah.
It saves a lot of trouble for everybody.
What else do you got on your report? You're up.
I have one question. I spoke to Pam Powers, who's the clerk of the courts. Proposed amendments, proposed changes to the ordinance that was going in front, did that ever get forwarded to the counselors?
Well, it got forwarded to, I know that Todd, because he CC'd me, forwarded to Carolyn Mish.
Okay.
So, oh yes, and he also, he also CC'd the proper bodies for the city council. So is that the clerk?
Yeah, Pam, I don't think so, because Pam didn't get it.
He didn't get it?
No, she did not get it, so I think that it may have gone to the respectful counselors. And she is the clerk of the council.
And she was the one that should have gotten it?
Most likely, or at least been put in the loop.
Okay, hold on. I'm trying to see if I can see who we sent it to. I'd have to dig around. I remember seeing him, I even asked him to double check with the city council, with calling the mayor's office to find out who to officially send our comments to. And I know that he did that.
Okay.
And then I saw him CC some people who looked like the right people, but I didn't double check it. So.
Okay, that's fine. I'm just curious. I just had a conversation with her and she was asking.
Okay. All right, so how about you and I close that loop after the meeting.
Received two emails from DCR acknowledging the fact that we filed our letter of intent from the DCR Challenge Grant, which I think we're going to talk about later in this meeting about what our steps going forward. Public shade tree hearings to follow up on the public shade tree hearing at 79 Elm Street. Smith College has withdrawn its request for the removal of the lindens. So we're in the process of finalizing a memo the mayor. I did meet with the mayor last Friday to discuss that, and Jay was there, President representing Smith. So since then, I've got letters basically rescinding their request to remove them. However, I do think that we are going to take down one of the lindens that was damaged by the truck because of the nature of its injuries, and that's becoming a hazard tree. So that'll be all included in the memo to the mayor. Google tree map, as Lily mentioned before, she sent the information in a Google Doc to Andy and myself, Andy Keither, GIS coordinator, and Andy has actually put it on the Google map so you can actually see it. But the problem is that he has not been able to actually get it to roll into the map itself, so it's in its own layer right now, so he has to draw it back out and put it in GIS and then send it back to the Google map. So he's kind of backed up with some other things, but hopefully he'll get to it by the end of this week. So we'll be good and we can start to actually move things around. Because what I've been doing basically is going to the map, when I did with Rob today, because we had some setback planning requests, and I basically go to the map and I adjust them and actually drop them right in the spot where the trees are going to be planted. So I've been working on it little by little, but I need to ramp it up because we're going to have to start putting stakes out in order to get ready for October 3rd. So, as long as I give myself about 5 to 6 days beforehand. I'm going to do one large trench permit for the DPW that's going to have all the locations of all the tree plantings, so we can get one. Unfortunately, every place needs its own dig safe number. So if you're working on the same street, it's okay, but if you change streets, then dig safe does not like giving just similar numbers.
Can we access that map with the same link, or will there be a new link?
No, you can access it with the same link. You can see it, you just can't edit it or do anything to it at this point, so.
And then the other thing that I sent to Andy and Rich is, I have been following all the surveys, the individual surveys that have been coming in through Survey Monkey, and anytime someone says I'm requesting a tree, either on the tree belt or as a setback tree, I've got a spreadsheet going for that, and Andy and Rich have access to that. And I'd say that's about, I don't know, maybe 50, 30, I have to look it up. It's significant.
It's actually kind of like exploded.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, it's kind of been an explosion.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, I feel like it's.
Well, we've been caught up.
Way out there, I'm trying to rein it in.
Yeah, I mean, that's what happens when you send out a press release and you get coverage on the.
But that's okay, that's a good thing, so.
Yeah, and to that point, are we going to prioritize public plantings over setbacks, or do a mix of the two, or have we thought about that?
I think that we should do, well, there's two different, I mean, there's three different, there's people that have asked for setback plantings. There's folks that have asked for trees to be planted in front of their house and the tree belt. And then there's everything else, you know, which is locations that I have based upon former tree locations and the locations that we looked at last week. So I think that my honest opinion is I think we should try to honor the folks who have asked for public shade trees in the tree belt first, and then go through and prioritize almost like a first come, first serve for setback plantings, and then do a mix of different locations between the list that I have in that Google map and then the gateway locations that we looked at last week. It's kind of hard. I mean, you have so many. I mean, it'd be nice to have like 5,000 trees in one day. You know, it just doesn't work that way.
Yeah.
But I think it would be good to get the people that have actually asked for trees in the public right of way, and also people that have asked for setback plans, because those people are bought into this program already. And so if we can honor their requests, then we really could actually ask those folks, now that the tree is out there, can you water it, please? Can you take care of it because you asked for it? So that will kind of, hopefully, that'll work, and then that'll kind of, those will go off of our radar screen for watering after the fact, but then we'll have to deal with all these other trees that we have that are in these different locations and figure out how we're going to get them maintained after we plant them.
Okay, so I just want to summarize that, because what we're talking about is, you know, how we're setting priorities for our limited resources, and I want to make sure everybody's on board.
There's sort of an additional aspect to what Rich just mentioned about they'll water it. It's also been discussed by some people at DPW familiar with having to plow and trim trees. Getting trees back from the street into the setback is a general goal, because the trees are often healthier and happier in setbacks than in the tree belt. So it might seem kind of counterintuitive to be putting trees on people's lawns when they're tree belt waiting, but there's an advantage to it.
Well, it depends on the tree belt. I mean,
yeah.
Really, yeah. So
well,
it's kind of
big tree belts, yeah. But most tree belts in most neighborhoods are fairly narrow, and so it's hard to put a big shade tree there. So, for instance, on Washington Avenue, which is a typical tree belt street, we have a nice tree belt, and there are huge maples in it. But still, if you put the maple on the homeowner's side, that tree will have a longer, healthier life, and it kind of helps out in different ways.
Okay, so it's pretty good. What Rich has suggested is that we prioritize as follows, and I think I only got as far as two, so help Rich helping with the 3 and 4. First, requested tree belt trees. Second, requested setback plantings.
Third would be the two lists that we have generated, the one that I have generated by former tree locations.
So former tree locations.
And the other list that we will continually generate, which is looking at locations when we go to scout out through gateways and things of that nature.
Okay, so this is the scouted, so, and of those scouted ones, are we prioritizing any? Are we prioritizing the gateways, are we prioritizing the walk-to-school routes, the bus stops, the, you know, do we wanna, the main, you know, the major streets, do we wanna set our priority a little bit more clearly?
Will there be enough left over after we do these other priority areas to have at least one or a few or a cluster at each of the sites that we identified? As partly for visibility?
There may be, but I don't have an answer for it.
Uh-huh.
Well, it's also not the only planting opportunity. Like, we're talking about fall, spring, fall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, presumably for as long as we can wind at them for purchasing trees, so it's not the only bite of the apple.
I'm just thinking the more it's spread around, maybe the more the residents will see, wow, it's quite extensive.
Well, I think after talking with Rob today, this is just another subject, Rob and I had a conversation about organizing planting days, and it would be a lot easier logistically if we had clusters of plantings, you know, just a, that one group of the eight works, you know, on one or two streets, you know, and then from there, you know, we have another group that works in another location that does one or two, three streets in that area.
Okay.
So for that aspect, I like your thought about trying to do clusters. It's just a matter of populating the whole, the map right now is kind of like a little crazy, you know, there's a lot of stuff in there that I put in there. And then Andy has another layer that we actually generated last week that I think I'd actually like him to take, maybe I can take it out of there for the time being and work on it. He's gonna take it out and put it in GIS and bring it back. But I have to sit with him and actually go through it a little to kind of clean it up a little bit. Because if you look at it now from the very beginning, it's just this whole, they're all circles, they're everywhere. So it's really just a little mind-boggling. So step by step, and I think we have to just concentrate on doing clusters of a combination of these plantings and how we go about deciding whether they're going to be in gateways, whether they're going to be in bus stops, I think will all depend upon what we have left after we fish through the first two.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this is like a kind of where the rubber meets the road planting stuff. I think from one level, like, I kind of feel like either one, we create a subcommittee to help Rich, or two, we just let him do his thing this time around and let him prioritize, plant, and then try to develop a strategy going forward for the spring. You know, there's a lot of different ways to do it.
Yeah.
And if
we don't want to bog you down.
Yeah, I feel like either if he has a vision, let's let him do it this time around so it gets done, and it gets done well, and then we can develop our priorities over winter.
All right. I think we've provided you already a list of what our hopes are, what our priorities, things like, you know, gateways, strategic places downtown if possible, school bus stops. Oh, I did finally get a list from the school system of bus stops, and they gave it to me in a PDF form, so I can try to, either I can give that to Andy and have him play with it, or I can put it on the spreadsheet myself. But anyway, that might be for spring and going forward.
Yeah.
But
interject that it gets, I mean, after doing this for the past three seasons, it gets crazy.
Yeah.
Because you don't know what the executive is going to tell you, you can actually plan. You don't know who's going to come out and start yelling at you. Like, there's so many variables at play that I think most importantly, I think as long as, like, Rich knows we have his back, you know, I think that's really good, because, I mean, it's not easy at all. And, like you don't know when you put a shovel in the ground, like, where you're going to find. It gets insane.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Okay. All right. That's a good reality check.
Yeah.
And actually, 100 trees is really, you know, as Rob and I were starting to talk about this today, and logistically, it's not going to take very long. We'll be out of trees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Rob and I figured about the month of October that we have will be done, and then we have 62 trees left at Amherst Nursery for the rowbacks, and that's it.
Yeah.
So potentially we could plant. We should be able to easily plant everything this fall. It's just getting preparation to dig safe, having the interaction with the residents that don't know anything about what we're doing. Well, so now there's a stake in front of their house, and then that generates a whole conversation. So that could be 50 conversations that Terry will intercept, because she'll get the first phone call and she'll say, he can't talk to you right now because he's in a meeting or something. And so, you know, it just creates this roller coaster effect. So
curious, Andrew, in Holyoke, have Have you guys been placing trees without consulting the immediate homeowner?
No, what we always did, and I don't know, there's two different ways of looking at it. First, you don't know where you can plant. So first, can we plant here? Yes, no. Okay, Panzel, good save. We think we can put like a swamp white oak here, you know. We can get a nice big tree here, we site everything out, and then once we get our number on estimates on how many trees we think we can plant, we go through and we give somebody an opt-out card. We're going to be planting a swamp white oak in front of your house on the, you know, the third week of September. If you don't want a tree, to check this box or call and tell us why not. You know, because that way, when the person gets angry that there's a tree in front of their house, there's always that sort of like fallback where, you know, we did outreach, we did everything we could to make sure you were aware that this was happening. We did it in English and Spanish, you know, so you know, we've done everything we possibly can. And the thing is, you have the right to plant the public right away, but you don't know until you start planting, like, how many people are going to get angry and call the mayor, and all of a sudden the mayor has to backpedal and not be as supportive because there's an election and there's all this like crazy stuff, you know. But presumably, as long as we have your back and the mayor has your back, you legally have the right to plant trees there. And if people are angry, then it's like you're getting something nice. Like,
I don't think we'll be back down.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It's not the police. I don't know. Stream sweeper. You know.
Yeah.
Just,
okay.
It's just I've had a lot of conversations like this before with folks, and it just it'll require, you know. Maybe we'll get 10, 15 phone calls
and
say you don't want a tree. And then that's one of the reasons I like to plant trees in old locations that had trees because people's memories, especially if you know, the house there's been no turnover, it's much easier than dealing with finding a location that hasn't had a tree for 30 years and all of a sudden you're going to block my view of such and such and then it generates a conversation. But
so this is good. So I'm glad we're having this conversation.
Can I ask a question about that? Are there stumps to be removed at any of these sites? Or are they...
Some of the places still have stumps, and we have been negligent in actually getting stump removal done because we've been trying to do a lot of tree work because we have about a week's worth of grinding to do. We've got about 60 stumps to take care of. Not all of them are places that will have trees because the tree belt's just not suitable. It was just a tree that was there from 100 years ago when there was just a gravel road and probably no sidewalk. So their conditions changed.
So how will you get feedback just by people seeing the stake that says tree on it? Is it, do you write tree on the loop?
Yeah. DPW takes a tree.
Right.
Keep it really simple. I don't want to make it too overly complicated.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this will be a good experiment.
Yeah.
We'll have to see exactly. I mean, obviously, we could run out of, you know, places to plant trees in essence that were old trees very quickly. So now we're going to places that hadn't had trees or had trees, they were there 30 years ago, you know, people, it's just going to be, it's going to be interesting, but I think the more positive press that we have,
and by starting with low-hanging fruit of people who've already requested them, then I do think that gets us some good momentum, and that it means that we sort of ease our way into confrontation with folks. I just want to make sure that we all feel comfortable with this strategy of putting trees where we feel they serve public benefit and not necessarily consulting ahead of time with the closest homeowner. There are different ways to do this, and I don't want to give away my hand because I don't want to tilt the discussion. I will say that there are communities like in Cambridge, I spoke to the tree warden there, where it's actually their municipal law that they cannot plant in a public right-of-way without getting the nearest homeowner's permission. So there's like all ends of the spectrum. So I just like to hear how, if this is the tack that Rich is gonna take, then we have to all be okay with covering his back on this strategy. But if we aren't, then we need to have this discussion ahead of time.
I have feelings both ways because I wanna see the job done, and I trust Rich's good judgment and expertise, but here we are, a new commission, and we're trying to, you know, get residents on board and supportive, and if time allows for this courtesy, it might be worthwhile. It might slow the process, but I guess my question would be, might there be any negative feedback coming back to us in terms of, we didn't know that you were doing this, and that that might not support our work going forward?
I think if you put the stake out, it says tree, and somebody doesn't want a tree there, you're gonna hear about it. Then we'll have time to deal with that.
Okay.
Because it's a big white stake, I mean, it's not.
Could it say tree with a phone number on it? I mean, how, is that a lot more work?
City tree will say, right?
It'll say tree, I can write them that way.
Well.
You can write them any way you like, you can put a phone number on it. They'll find it.
Yeah, yeah.
Put somebody else.
If one of us was willing to make phone calls, would that be helpful? Is it that we don't have the manpower or woman power, or is it just that it's just an added step that you don't see to be all that useful?
Well, I haven't really experienced a lot of trouble in the past with planting trees. I mean, I've experienced some issues with planting trees that I've kind of had to negotiate to the point where I tell the residents, you like to breathe, and that's usually the end of the conversation. I hate to be that crass, but that's kind of really what it amounts to.
There'd probably be like 2 or 3 people out of 100, maybe.
I feel like maybe in the future that we can, just as Andrew was saying before about making some kind of more thoughtful or more full discussion about prioritizing where we want to plant next spring's trees or next fall's trees, but I kind of feel like, you know, it's like weeks away, you know, just that amount of administrivia is going to be, to me, would be an impossible job.
Okay, how about if we have a list of all the sites and we put it on our website? This is where we are planning to plant.
I think just putting the stake out is going to be enough. If somebody doesn't want the tree there, they're going to see the stake and they're going to say, I'm going to call them, because I don't want a tree there.
What's going on?
I mean, I like your idea though of actually putting like a little door hanger on people's doors, just to say, where, you know, what the tree board, the public safety commission, you're planting a tree in front of your house. If you have any questions or comments, please call. You know, I do like that thought process, but I don't know if we can pull that all off in order to get it.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
That's what I was saying.
I think it's something we can strive for the spring, but I think that if we go for the, you know, that tiered priorities of requested trees and then trees in where they are recently taken down, so that there's still that memory, I think we can maybe pump this discussion a little bit further down the road. Does anyone else have any other comments about it? I'm just going to say that I tend to lean where Rich leans, which is, for me, we're about public benefit. We're not about private benefit. I realize it's a balance point, but I personally have found that when you ask people, they start dreaming up all these reasons why having a tree in front of their house can be, you know, a liability for them. And it usually gets them all nervous. So I feel like a little bit it opens a can of worms. And it certainly creates a lot of work for Rich and makes his job a lot more murky. So I tend to be a little bit more black and white in this and say, hey, look, we're, you know, it's public property, we're providing public benefit, end of story.
Okay, so how about, how do you guys, well, what do you think about doing a list on our site then? Because if I was not on this commission and I didn't have any friends on it, and I was wondering, oh, where are these trees going to go? I could go to the site and see. It could be after the fact, but at least we can offer to the public, these are where the trees have been planted. Does that seem of value?
Sure, I mean, you're going to have a spreadsheet anyway, so you can just put the spreadsheet up there, right? Like, I mean,
yeah,
you could. It's going to be like a...
It could be a link.
It's going to be a Google Doc, really, is what it is.
I don't see the harm in that. But
just so people can have sort of a bird's eye view of where the trees are, is that it?
Yeah, personally, I would love to see that even as a commissioner, like, oh, okay, where did these trees go? And it could be a simple list, and or it could also be the map. And I think that could be a nice service, because then people...
So, it seems to me like we're moving in that direction with the tree inventory.
Mm-hmm.
And so I see that the tree inventory, as the one in Amherst, is transparent. You can go and you can access it, you can see the inventory. You can't manipulate it, but you can see it. So I think we can make that as a goal. And if people ask in the short term, we can say, hey, look, we're in the process of creating a larger tree inventory, and we'd be delighted to share that information when we have it.
I want to follow what you were saying, Lily.
Yeah.
In an ideal world, and this is what I support as a vision, if there's an opportunity for the public to see a tree in public right away, put a tree there. And I think the important thing is if someone's angry and they want to yell at Rich, then they can also come and yell at us too.
Yeah.
And they're like, I'm mad. Okay, let's hear it. Tell us why you're mad, you know? And I think the important thing is this very fine line between we can put a tree there if we want to, no matter what you say, and our goal is to, you know, plant public shade trees, yeah. And this is how we're going about it.
Yes.
You know, and I think sometimes some of the attitudes that I run into is that I can't do anything about it, so don't complain, take the tree and visit it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's difficult, you know, to kind of navigate that space between,
yeah,
respectfully,
right,
educating.
Yeah, and I'm always in favor of rare exceptions. Like, for example, I just want to make sure that we're keeping.
Yeah.
So this is, I just realized that we're sort of, you know, getting into a deep topic in the middle of your tree warden report, but I didn't know if you had much more on
No.
it. The next topic at 4:55 would have been fall planting planning, so
Okay.
it's somewhat one and the same, but let's talk about this for 5 more minutes and then we'll move on. I certainly don't want to make people city haters and tree haters. That would not be achieving our goal. I'm a huge fan of having a general rule and acknowledging that there are some exceptions to that, and you can make those on an individual basis. But when you start putting it out there, like if you'd like to opt out of a tree, having a tree, it makes it a little easier for folks. I'd like it to be a little bit harder. One of the things that is coming down the pike in Greenfield, they have this draft ordinance that's going through City Council that actually makes me a little concerned. It's supposed to strengthen tree protection in the town, and it has this clause about solar collection systems, and it says, the tree warden and DPW director shall not allow a tree to be planted on town property or on private property where the town is paying for that tree that will negatively impact an active or planned solar collection system. This is going to come up in our town too. And so it did make me think about, like, well, that angry homeowner that says, I'm about to put up a solar array. You just planted a tree in an area that's going to block my future solar array.
Or say they already have one.
Yes.
Say they have a $10,000 solar array in their house.
Mm-hmm.
You obviously shouldn't put a big tree.
You can put a harvey.
Yeah.
There's like small,
yeah,
trees.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. Beautiful small tree.
Yeah.
So, all right, so let's think about short term and long term. In the short term, are we going to do anything other than just put a stake up where it says tree? Because if we do it, it's more administrative.
Correct. I think for this round, I think putting a stake up is done typically in the past.
Okay.
We'll just see where that goes. And I'll deal with the individual homeowners case by case.
Okay.
And
then
I'll just go out and talk with
any them. Any numbers on it? Or did this just say tree?
It's going to say DPW tree, and then I have to paint on the ground and dig save so they can come and dig save it. But I typically don't, and I'll just, that will be correlated with the Google map. So, and then I'll just write in the species of what tree selected for that, depending on what the location is, and we'll just go from there.
Okay, and then, do we want to also have some kind of link on our website to the master list of where we're planting trees? I don't know if we're going to be able to do it.
I think after we're done, we'd be fine to take the time to do that.
Okay.
So people have that reference. I don't think we need to do it before.
Well, anybody can view the map. It's a Google doc, it can be shared with anyone, so they can view it, they just can't edit it.
Yeah.
And they can see trees we planted in the past, trees that are proposed, trees that are approved. So, I mean, it's just about navigating through it and actually looking at it. But I mean, I think one of the problems is that we're kind of like in between. We don't have a tree inventory.
Right. Yeah.
We don't really have a dedicated, we have a dedicated work order system that identifies the work tasks, how much they cost on trees. But that can be viewed by the public, but it's just but for the regular person, it's just mumbo jumbo to them. So we're kind of like in between.
Okay.
And we're also trying to find a new work order system. We're working on, MIS is working on a new work order system, which may change all that, which, again, will be hopefully tied somehow either through to GIS, so we can add the inventory, so we can actually, you know, basically go do tree work, and it actually says, okay, this tree was removed, and then I can go to the inventory and just take it out. And that would be the ideal world. Because then it would take a lot of data entry steps out of it.
Yeah.
So we're kind of in, in between.
So while we're in between, why don't I do this? Why don't I work with Andy to put on the website a hot link to the Google, the view only Google map, and I'll just say, while we're in process of creating a tree inventory, we offer this map to the public to view where upcoming or recent trees have been planted. Something like that. I mean, it's just making it clear that it's just a stopgap database. Does that work for folks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. All right. Good. Anything else on your tree warden report?
No, other than I really enjoyed last weekend a lot.
Yeah, the training?
Yeah.
It was great to have all the tree crew there.
Yeah, they enjoyed themselves. So they'll be an integral part of how we move forward to getting these trees planted in October, so, which I think we'll end up talking about again at some point. So, yeah, it was awesome. I had a good time.
All right.
It's nice to get dirty. I would be dirty during the day like you used to, so it's a nice feeling.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm trying to figure out where I am here in this whole agenda.
Fall planting.
And what, sometimes I put dots in. Next steps for site choice decisions. Okay, we really had that conversation, right? Mm-hmm. And that's exactly. Yeah. There's just one more thing about that I'd like to say, and that is, I know we're trying to, we're going to do our best to match the right tree for the right site. If it turns out that we have a weird mishmash left over of trees that aren't really well suited for particular sites, and I don't mean in terms of like utility wire interference, but for me, it's more important that that's important too, but it's important that especially big spaces that are able to accommodate a shade tree get that shade tree. So my hope is just that if there's a space and only a small tree, and it's a space that can accommodate a big tree, I'd rather just not fill that space.
Mm-hmm.
And find another space. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I very much think so, yeah. When you put a small tree, it permanently takes up that space. Mm-hmm. So that for 100 years, that's what will be there.
Mm-hmm.
Unless there's a solar panel.
That's actually a good topic. I just want to touch on that for 2 seconds.
Yeah.
I know I'm out of my realm, but I have talked to different tree care companies in town, and they said that about 50% of their work, private work, has been to remove private trees to make way for solar arrays. Dan Dossel in particular has done a tremendous amount of work in doing tree removals.
I think we've got some education we need to have about the cost-benefit analysis that needs to happen before those decisions are made.
It's kind of scary. Exchanging one benefit mm-hmm. to try to gain another.
Yeah.
There are tree farms that you can buy into as if there were in your house. I mean, there's
solar farm.
Yeah,
solar farm. Right.
Yeah.
I own a part of a solar farm.
Right.
Worked pretty well. So, mm-hmm. and you see them now, like when you drive on the interstates, mm-hmm. you see the big racks.
Yeah.
So this was the conversation I wanted to have with Chris Mason today.
Yeah.
So I feel like we need his support too. I think that he's looking through his energy lens very much in the way of like renewable energy mm-hmm. and less in the way of energy saved by mm-hmm. shading and protecting your house from wind and all that. So I agree.
Mm-hmm.
So
right,
let's make sure we get him back.
Yeah.
So, next up, site choice, volunteer organizing. I did send out a doodle poll to the leaders only. I did that because I'd like to see how many leaders we have on a given day before I send out the doodle poll to the general volunteers, and then I might have to modify the request to the volunteers if we don't have enough leaders. There are a lot of volunteers, and we're looking forward to having at least two or three student groups joining the 24 individuals from Northampton that have volunteered. So the two or three student groups will be about 10 or 16. So we have probably a pool of 35 or 40 people altogether, and we need about 24 a day on each day. Mm-hmm. It's hard to tell. I mean, you know, you can tell the Google folks about it. It's hard to tell what we actually have.
Are you counting us as volunteers?
I'm counting just the leaders.
Unless you've signed up.
Unless you signed up, which you didn't, but I'd like to sign up.
I assume we're all volunteers.
No, I wouldn't make that assumption. Okay. They're not making that assumption.
All right.
No, but
if you do, like, email us and we'll...
Complete the duty.
Go ahead.
I have a meeting on September 21st with the Key Club in at the high school. That's a public service. That's like the Rotary. So I'm going to talk. They wanted me to come to the meeting, so I'm going to go talk to them, and then Rob and I will figure out how many people we need. And that may be a pool. That's a big club, so they may need, you know, maybe a larger pool. And if we need more people, I'm kind of holding off on, like, contacting the Boy Scouts yet, or I can probably get the swim team to, you know, come too. The other thing, I had a meeting with Smith Volk today, and I'll give you the quick information, and then if somebody wants more of the details, if there's time or somebody's question. So they can and are very interested in planting trees. They would have to do it during the week, like not during.
And he,
yeah, and he could dedicate an entire week to plant if we need it. And he's pretty interested in having it as an ongoing thing.
Who's your contact?
Jim Ansbach is his name. He's a good guy.
Yeah. In the forestry department?
Yeah, forestry horticulture. I'm on the advisory board for that shop. And Mark Nevin's the other instructor. So so I have kind of details about dates that would work well for them. I talked to him about the nursery too. Should I go ahead and talk about that?
Yeah, sure. Okay.
I talked to him about the nursery too. He is very interested in continuing the nursery at that site. Is it actually school land, or is it the state land that the school uses?
No, it's on school land. Okay. Right off of South Main Street.
Right. It's in an apple orchard. There's an acre available there. There is water there. We may need to, it will get, he felt, I asked him several times whether he could really pull off in the curriculum to plant and prune and stuff like that, maintain. And he said he felt like he could, and he was dedicated to do that. I know historically there's been some fall off on that. I don't really know all the details, but he did say over the summer for 8 weeks somebody would probably have to come and water, but anybody could get in there. And my thought was, well, maybe that could be several of our pool of volunteers. We could get to be waterers down there.
That's a great role for volunteers.
Yeah, and then they also currently have trees there that many of them are, like, very large, I guess, and need to go. So there's approximately 20 zelkovas, and those are 4 to 6 inches big trees.
I'll pick them up.
Yeah, there's maples, some red and some sugar. He was interested in using the sugar maples in the sugar bush, but I don't know if that's okay. 20 to 25, a mix of red and sugar, mostly red maples.
Would these trees need to be removed before we could start a nursery? They would.
Mm-hmm. So and then there's about 6 ginkgos that are 1 inch that he felt like they weren't ready. And there's some lilacs. There's about 6 lilacs.
Tree lilacs?
No, they're shrub. He wasn't sure what, I didn't go get a chance to go look at them, but I could probably figure out what they are.
Those larger trees, we planted, we bought those, so they actually belong to the city. I mean, they belong to the city, but the Department of Public Works bought them as bare root stock. Students planted them.
Right.
And there they have sat, and then the forestry department kind of went through a bunch of changes.
It did.
And what happened is that they used to use, the head of the forestry department wasn't Jim before, it was Johnson Francis. He used to actually come and work in the summer months with CETA kids, and they would actually mow the nursery, and they would mow and trim the nursery, and it was groomed. And then this CETA program fell apart, a bunch of budget cuts happened, and then no one took care of it. So we kind of took care of it for a while, and then it just got to be too much for us, so.
Because this is a fairly substantial deviation from our agenda item, let's do this. I want to hear the rest of this, let's put it under any other business.
Okay.
And pick it up there, because I'm aware that you guys have some time-sensitive stuff that you need to, you know, we want to make sure that we're all on board to support you in the coming 6 weeks. So the nursery can wait for a little while.
Yeah, the only thing is I do have to figure out, he was willing to plant trees that we already have, you know, as part of the program. I personally think it would be a good idea to get the folks who are involved, you know, just to.
The kids.
Absolutely. Yeah, and even if it was 2 days, it doesn't have to be entire week of planting, you know, 30 trees.
Well, get them to help plant trees, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but it would have to be during the week.
I'm not volunteering for that. If I could provide, you need, I do have some issues there. We've used them to plant trees for us before, and they did it incorrectly.
It was bad.
Well, part of why I'm volunteering, I'm assuming that someone, one of the leaders will have to, some leader, which I'm now included in, would have to go along. And they were given instructions, and they did it their own way anyway.
Okay.
I want to make sure we're on the same page.
I think we actually have to physically be there.
Before that.
That's good.
Sounds like Rob's going to be there, right?
Yeah, I'm going to be here and there, and maybe.
So you'd be able to be there during weekdays?
Yeah. If we have 15 kids running around planting trees, you're not going to be with every one of them.
Well, it'll have to be more than just me.
I think we need to have maybe a training.
Yeah.
They've got to be willing to play it our way.
I think what's important is that if the school curriculum or forestry's curriculum is such that the trees are planted in this fashion, then it's up to us to speak to the instructor to make sure that their planting methods are similar to the ones that we approve of. Because sometimes I think that's where the disparity is, and then there's only Mr. Anspaugh and the other teacher, so they end up, and there's so many kids. And it depends also on the age group, so if you have freshman students who are rotating in and out, our sophomores, they are less experienced than juniors and seniors who actually want to be in forestry and may have a little more of an interest in doing things correctly or have paid attention already for the last couple of years, so.
But yeah, Jay, I've already gotten feedback about this whole thing where I know that if they're just let loose, that they won't be done.
No, they let loose, they just kind of teenagers.
So I don't know if I'm the only one of the leaders that can come along, or that maybe there are others.
I can do Fridays.
I could probably do something during the, like if I take some time off, I could probably help out with that.
Yeah, so I mean.
So, because maybe we want to start this small, maybe we want to say, we'll start with a small group of juniors and seniors.
I mean, with at a minimum, three or four, so that one of us can go out with them, plant some, I don't know, something like that. I totally agree with Jay, we have to be totally in control of it, and that follow his, Jay's lead as to how the trees were planted, even if Jay can't do the demonstration, maybe he can't.
Well, I'd be willing to do one with them.
That's what I'm saying. So maybe we arrange a demonstration with them, but even then, I would still want to personally have you or Rich or me or or somebody on the days they're working.
Keep in mind that this is something we could punt to spring too. We don't have to do all of these, you know, we don't have to bring in every potential stakeholder group this time around.
Agreed.
So keep it manageable for yourself, folks.
Yeah.
One thing we could do is get the Amherst nursery trees and maybe put them at Smith School for the winter.
It's a possibility. I think we just need to see how many.
Yeah, I'm just saying, you know.
Yeah, I agree. We need to see how many volunteers we get.
Okay.
How we do with planting the trees that we have already. And then, this is just like this is a work in progress, right? We're drawn from all these different resources, and there's a lot of good resources, and we want to include them all. but we, I think having the buy-in from the public is extremely important. So I like the process where we're going, but I also like using the students, because we used to use the students a lot, and then things change, but I think going back to that would be really good. But I think it's just how to fit them in, and maybe we could actually fit them in, like Jay said, but maybe utilize them to do the plantings that we can't get done with the volunteers before winter sets in.
That was actually, yeah, his window was a little bit better in November.
Where they actually would work with the full-time DPW crew and coordinating plantings during the daytime.
Yep.
You know, so I think there's a couple of different ways to go about it.
That's a good idea.
That's what we used to do in the past. We would, basically, we gave them the bare root stock, they grew it for 5 years. They went in the nursery, they bought the burlap, they actually pulled it out themselves, they put it on trailers. I went around and dig-safed everything, and they planted them. That's before we had a bona fide tree crew.
And how did they do?
Some of them were okay, some of them weren't okay.
Yeah.
It all depended upon the age, really, I think it all depends upon the age group of the students and the size of the class. Because when there's 15 kids, you just can't keep track of everything.
Well, there's just too many of them.
Right.
All right.
Okay.
Cool.
I wanted to back up before we got to the information packets. And Jim, with you, to just talk a little bit about the format that we're gonna have another meeting before the first planting, I'm not sure, but the format is we're all gonna, volunteers are all gonna meet in the field, and apparently there'll be some people want to spend a few minutes speaking.
You mean at Sheldon Field?
Yep, at Sheldon Field. So, and that apparently might include anyone from the mayor to Rich, Jim, JP, Lily, different people. And that, Jim is working on what that's gonna look like. Right, Jim?
Yes.
Yeah. And so, but then, and the part I'm trying to get to is that after, so we'll try and make it quick, we'll try and meet quickly, talk about, you know, so we can get to actually planting trees. After that, we're gonna try and figure out a way to have people actually meet at the sites that they're gonna be planting at. And I haven't quite figured out how to do that, you know, once we've had our first introductory meeting.
Rather than meet at Sheldon Field every time?
Yeah, well, maybe we haven't discussed that.
We'll have a different group every time.
Yeah, I think we're gonna have to meet at a central location no matter what. I think we have to do that.
I'm trying to avoid this for time saving.
Sure, right. Yeah.
You know, just to avoid it, we have to have the leaders know who's in their group, and then people go meet the leaders.
I think it would be easier to break it down that way, let the leaders decide how they wanna.
How their group, find them, meet their group.
Yeah. After the first, after the.
Problem is the groups are gonna change slightly, because the volunteers won't be the same ones every time.
That's why I think bringing it back to Sheldon each time is gonna be important. I know it's gonna take a little time.
Yeah. Anyone have any ideas how to avoid it? I mean, just.
Are you trying to get each group to plant three or four trees? What's three?
Three or four, and, you know, I actually.
After Saturday, I think three.
I'm thinking three.
Well, we're also now thinking maybe four people, including the leader in the group, rather than three.
Yes, groups of four.
People might get tired, like, these are big trees.
We switched to four people in each group.
Okay.
I mean, ideally, all these numbers work out, I mean, and then only doing three trees. Some people will have the capacity to plant more than three.
Well, yeah.
Maybe they can go help out people that are, so that.
They're not all bone brilliant, right? There's grow bag trees too, and the grow bags are like these tree trees.
No, the only thing we have is all burlap container at the moment.
The grow bags are out, you know, we're still gonna stay there until we kind of got them down the road.
So the volunteers are gonna do a lot of P&amp;B?
But Rich has a auger that, theoretically, that's coming.
Came today.
Oh, so he had, I don't wanna speak for you, but he said that he could go where the B&Bs are gonna go. He could like pre-drill, so all we have to do is scoop out.
Well, that's gonna take a lot of time on it.
You better believe it.
Yeah, so I think we're a little kind of three or four. I think we still remain a little bit at three or four. I don't know how we'll deal with it.
Pleasure. I think we're gonna have to go through the first weekend.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's the outcomes, make adjustments.
Just like we learned from this last week.
Oh, yeah, totally.
So,
Yeah, so maybe just put out three for the first weekend, and if people finish too soon, then we'll give them a bigger bite.
Information packets. That's one of the reasons Mira is here tonight, see if she can help with that. If there is help that needs to be done.
I haven't, to be honest with you, I haven't really got that far yet, thinking about that. But, you know, I thought originally we had to, like, match everybody up, but then Rob and I talked, and I thought, all right, we could just meet at Sheldon Field and say, all right, we need, you know, four people with each leader. And, you know, because some people are going to want to work together, some people, you know. Mm-hmm. And then we can kind of assess, like, well, we need somebody who's a little bigger and stronger in this group, or, you know. I mean, that's my vision of the way we could pull it off. So the only, the packets we need then are just a leader and a destination, really, right?
Well, we want that diagram, the planting diagram.
Oh, okay.
I think, just so people can understand, like.
Like a.
A root ball, a root flare. I mean, mm-hmm. It's always great to have, mm-hmm. have that in the, I have one. Mm-hmm. You know, that I got from someone who got from DCR. You know.
You mean how to plant, properly plant a tree?
Yeah, they should basically, like, give them a cut sheet.
Yeah, a cut sheet. I think it's nice to have so you have a visual of it. Yep. I mean, I know it's, they're going to actually see it in action, but somehow I think that's a nice thing to have. Mm-hmm. So where we're going, a little cut sheet, maybe something about watering so we can hand them out. And I don't know how the homeowners can get these. So it seems like planting, watering, and where planting and watering are three things that should be constantly aware of.
And then just prior to that, making sure everybody brings water and snacks and that there is a first aid kit at every site.
Oh, we don't have that.
First.
I think we need something.
Yeah.
We had a minor, but we had an injury just on our training, and those are like super experienced people. But even if it's just an ouch pouch with band-aids, I think that would be wise to have.
Rob just keeps looking over here.
Yeah, I'm looking over there. I mean, do you have on the shelf just sitting there? Like,
yeah, we actually have small first aid kits. We have to put in all the trucks for all their inspectors.
On the trucks, right. Mm-hmm.
So I could have it around.
Oh, and didn't you say, Rich, that there'd be a member of the tree crew that would be at a lot of these sites?
So hopefully everyone's going to work every weekend.
Okay, that's
fine. So the format is that there'll be one truck following 2 liters.
Okay.
For every 2 liters, there'll be a truck support.
Okay.
So the truck will have the 55-gallon drum on it, and we've determined it'll probably be easiest to dole out water through 5-gallon pails, 20 to 25 gallons per tree. And then when we have to go and refill up, we're either going to have a truck come and fill the pickup truck, or we're going to have the pickup truck go somewhere else. I kind of like the idea of having the truck be filled up on the site so they don't take off and go back to the DPW yard and get lost.
Yeah.
Do you have tons and tons of 5-gallon buckets?
Yeah.
Okay, so you could potentially, they could, ahead of time or somewhere while people are digging.
Could dispense water.
Yeah, dispense water, because that could slow things. You know, just draining a 55-gallon drum could be slow.
I don't see another way to dispense it, because I don't think that I have enough water.
Yeah, no, that's fine, just as long as they.
That's a good way.
You know, they try. They start early of time so that no one's standing around waiting for the water. Or
if every truck has a 55-gallon drum, I think that should be fine, because the DCR does the same thing, and they'll just strap up two of those for like a day of planting for like 10 or 12 trees. So if there's one per truck, and that should handle 3 or 4 trees without having to refill.
Yeah, I mean, when we were planting the growback trees, I'm pretty sure we were putting 10 gallons on each growback tree. These are bigger pits, so maybe more water.
What's your recommendation for gallons?
The drum's only 55 gallons, so
a little
over a tree.
Usually
when you're
first planting, I think that's
super dry,
so I try to flood them.
But for 3 trees, it should be enough, right?
One barrel for 3 trees.
15 gallons per tree, maybe?
Should be.
You never know, right?
Right. But so if that's the case, then the truck would have to go refill once, or be refilled once. The
the barrel.
How about name tags? Do we want to have name tags?
That would be
a nice thing.
Well, the only reason I wanted name tags is that I have to get a release from each person.
Yep. That's a great idea.
And the name tag's connected to the release, then I can tell if they have their tag once they got the release. I don't know if I got it back.
Yep.
What are you doing?
Are you going to be floating?
No.
Oh, you're not?
No. Jen's floating.
You're floating. Okay, well then you should just have a clipboard and a release form and have people sign right there in front of you.
Okay, so you mean go to the sites and...
Well, no, Sheldon Field, before you leave.
Sheldon Field, right.
Yeah.
That's actually good that we're going to go there every time, because that's when we're going to issue radios, name tags, release forms.
Ouch pouches.
Basically, ouch pouches, and then actually just have, and Andrew's laughing about that, but it's what it is, an ouch pouch. And then basically just figure out who's going to be going with who.
Right.
I think that's good, right, you know?
I think it's going to be worth the extra 20 minutes or whatever in efficiency.
And then if we do three trees, that gives everybody really basically an hour or so to work on each tree.
Right.
If we keep them in a centrally located place, you know, two or three streets apart from each other, I think that'll work really well.
Yep.
And then we'll just gauge it after the first round, how we do. If we can add another tree, great. If we can't, then...
Yeah.
Right.
There's no reason for anybody to be sitting around watching this.
Right.
You know, somebody can be cutting the bottom out, somebody can be cutting the root ball top, somebody can be digging the whole thing.
Yeah. Okay. Let's go.
Safety vests?
Yeah, I mean, when we did our inventory, Todd Beal had a whole slew of them that he lent to us. Do you have a ton of safety vests? Be nice, at least one per group.
But you have enough. Everybody has one.
Yeah, it'd be great. Because you know what? People then ask questions, and like, oh, what are you guys doing up there?
It also, some people don't like people even stepping off the curb when they're drivers. We've had that. In a small plant, people are like, you know, you can't be here. So if you have a vest on, then you can be there.
All right.
Terry just brought something up, actually. We have DPW t-shirts that are like a safety green, but my wheels are turning now, and why can't we have, it would be nice, we should have thought about this maybe, but have t-shirts that say tree volunteer or something, and just give them to the people that volunteer.
Well, yeah, I mean, we...
Well, we don't have a plethora of money to buy these t-shirts.
Right, that's what we're
talking about. It would have to be thought about going down the road.
Down the road.
Yeah.
We talked about that one point, didn't we? Like, we decided not to...
Well, we didn't have the money.
We don't have the money. But I have vests that we can just collect, like the radios.
Yeah.
We can just hand those out.
That'll be fine.
And Rob and I are going to meet, you can put that on the to-do list, Rob and I are going to meet sometime in the next week.
Do you have those on hand, some of those on hand?
What's that?
The DPW bond? No, they don't say volunteer.
No, the DPW t-shirts have the city logo on them. I can't get those out to...
Right.
Civilians.
Yeah, because if somebody wears one, they go and...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I was just thinking something for the leaders to wear, so that people know that they're the leaders, but that was a good thing.
We can write leader on top of our...
Leader, yeah. Yeah, we might give them a different name tag.
Or just...
Great big one. Flowers.
Okay, anything else, Chuck?
I don't have anything else. Do you have anything else? I do have a little bit more on this nursery thing, but...
Yeah, okay.
The one thing I just wanted to say about the info packets, my thought was to get multiple uses out of them. If we're going to create a packet that's two or three pages, this pages that are standardized, like, you know, how to plant a tree and the steps to watering, if you had something that was standardized, we could just laminate those. And we could just use a ring binder and hold them together. And then we could just add that particular day's location to the packet and hand to the leader and say, here you go. And then we just collect those at the end, just like the vests, the radios, and everything else. I can get those laminated if you give me a cut sheet that you need.
That'd be good too, yeah, if it's rainy or wet.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Do you
have
to do the laminating?
Sure.
We just have to get them to you.
Yeah, I have a large laminator at work.
Speaking of rainy or wet, I assume that light rain is not going to deter us, but a downpour is just shitty conditions for planting trees?
Right.
And we have to figure out how we would cancel or let people know that.
I think just by email.
Just an email.
The night before, maybe say, you know, look, check your email first, you know, first thing tomorrow.
I don't have email at home. Or a smartphone.
Okay, for you. We'll call you.
Okay, what's your address?
You live high on a mountain.
We'll call you.
He just wanted to be.
I like that.
Doesn't want to know.
We'll send a pigeon.
Well, anyway, I think an email beforehand and I guess Jen and I will have to figure out.
Great, we can talk about it.
Okay, moving on from this item, and we're talking next steps with the DCR grant proposal.
Did we get the letter saying that it was received?
Yes, I have, I got the emails the other day.
Cool, that's good.
From Julie and from Molly.
So did they say it was eligible to go to the, oh, that's good.
If you have any questions, please.
So cool, yeah, I guess if you could forward that to me, because then we just have to, I'll just do a budget and a narrative and then bounce off y'all, and I'll try to obviously reflect the letter of intent.
Yes, this is what I was, I said, hi, I hope this is from Molly. Hi, I hope this email find you well. Received the intent to apply for a DCR Urban and Community Forestry Challenge Grant. Proposed project appears to be eligible to compete for DCR grant money. Please note that the application will be due by November 1st, 2015. Please feel free to contact me with any questions as you go through the application process. Thank you. Best, Molly.
Cool, that's good.
Right, so it being a matching grant, you two have to work closely on how to create this match, you know, what's going to be in kind, what's going to be actual dollars committed. Yeah. Does it look, have you taken a look at the grant proposal? I remember that their grants are not that, I mean, they take some.
It's not easy. I mean, you're probably looking at probably 10 pages, maybe.
Yeah. And then do they want letters of recommendation or anything like that?
Yeah, I think I have letters of support for my grant, so. Yeah, I mean, they don't hurt,
Yeah.
So letters of support are good. The big one is, the thing they look for more than anything else is having the tree warden.
Yeah, the tree warden. And, oh, that's not me this time.
But I think my goal with that is, I'll work with Rich, we'll develop the narrative in the budget, and we'll provide it to you. October, I guess, so the October meeting would be ideal.
Okay.
So normally we meet in October.
The 7th.
Yeah. Okay, so is that the only meeting?
But let's just shoot for that.
October 7th?
Right. And then we'll have a backup to
you. Right.
So we'll get that.
Fudge factor.
October 7th.
Do you need in advance to put the budget together? Do you need some, do you need to reach out to some tree inventory folks and get an estimate?
It's a good question. I don't know.
Did someone, I feel like in a previous meeting, somebody, maybe it was you, Jay, said you'd reach, it may not have been, said that they'd reach out to a couple of companies, was it you?
I reached out to Al Snow to actually get their RFP. So we can take a look at that and utilize that. It doesn't really typically have any numbers attached to it, but we can actually look at it. I can actually request a copy of the actual awarded bid to the vendor from Al, and then that will kind of give us a, you know, general idea of what.
I think I know in the letter, in the application I made for the Heritage Tree Grant, they required an actual bids from vendors for the cost of the
right,
job.
Right, prior to.
I mean, I know I submitted it with it, and I think it makes for a stronger application. I can't remember if it was required.
The problem with that, though, is that you can't actually, in order to
be valid that far in advance.
Yeah, the problem is that when you go to actually put an RFP out, you're requesting services or something, you have to have finances to back it up.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's one of the issues.
But what about just an estimate?
What you do is you call around. I mean, Rich is doing, he's calling people who've done it before, find ballpark numbers. I think 60,000, I think that'll get us the work. You know? I think we'll be able to do everything with that.
I
towns as sort of your guidance, but it's town data for that, so we're...
And Chickpea just did theirs, and they spent, originally they went for 45, I think they had to go over by 20,000, so they're like 65,000 for theirs, but I don't know about yours.
But showing some of that knowledge might, instead of an actual, it's a, it's a basic, so I think you're actually doing it.
Do you want me to support you with trying to pull together letters of support, would that be helpful?
That would be awesome, because that's always good, yeah, it's great.
Any ideas around the room of who I can approach?
What kind of, what, like what kind of letter of support are you looking for?
Well, I was thinking a lot of people who've come and visited us who are, you know, intersecting trees, like...
Not like from the mayor?
Well, I don't think it'd hurt to have it from the mayor. Oh, I mean, we are the applicant, but still, it could be,
Outside.
Economic development?
Yeah, I was thinking of Terry.
Yeah, I mean, the people who come and talk to us, you know?
Yeah, who else has come to talk to us, help me here, Stonewater guy, Doug?
Wayne.
Wayne, Doug, and then I'm just trying to think of Joe Northampton, just a citizen who has been involved in tree care, or tree advocacy, who has wanted this long time. You know who's actually a really good writer is Paige Bridges, I may ask her.
Who is that?
Paige, she's volunteering, and she's a good writer.
Yeah, community support, that's good.
Yeah. Trying to think of any community group. I was just thinking like the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association or something like that. You know, can you think of any groups? I'll maybe approach Ward 3 because they're gelled pretty well.
Cool.
Okay.
So
I'll work on that piece.
That's great.
Anything else about that?
I don't think so.
Okay. I'm gonna reverse this and do any other business first and then to-do list. Okay, just because things might come up. Be to-dos. All right, any other business? I wanted to mention one thing, but I'm happy to take other people's business first.
I just wanted to mention that Rich and I met with Wayne about other sites for nurseries in the city. And he's come up with a list of potential sites, and Rich and I are trying to get together to go out and actually look at those sites.
Okay.
Places that don't require clearing 6-inch cell codes.
Don't require clearing what?
Is there equipment that would stay around? The came when we were discussing that is you could, I don't know how long they've been in this spot, those trees.
Yeah.
But I would go in and root prune them this fall. See how they do next spring, and if they're viable, we might be able to sell them.
I'm gonna say 2000.
There are companies will come in and buy big trees.
Oh, really?
2006, maybe.
You mean the ones that are Smith Folk now?
Yeah. 2006, 2007.
We had talked about root pruning. I mean, that was part of the discussion.
Somebody's got a project, and they know the trees have been root pruned ahead of time. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. They might be interested.
That's a great idea.
How much would a 6-inch cover cost, like, under the market?
If you're going to buy one?
Yeah, $800,000 or?
In that ballpark.
Yeah.
I don't know what we could get.
Anything would be good.
Yeah. Get somebody to take them out and give us a little bit of money for it. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think it's very exciting that we have some water surgery.
Yeah, if you have to declare the tree surplus property.
That'll give us a lot more options. As far as plant material.
And control over the quality.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any of these sites have water?
A couple of them have, we could pump water.
Yeah, we could pump water from streams.
I think we'll do
one. No, you can't. Bad. No. No. Unless it's the agriculture use.
Right.
Well, that's agriculture.
Okay.
So one of the things that I find interesting, most of the sites though are one of their conservation restrictions is they can't have fences, which creates a little bit of a problem. cool site.
Well, I think Smith Boat would be the ideal spot. It would be. I mean, volunteers could get to it easily. It's fenced in now, it has water there.
It would be, nice to be have a location that is not controlled by any other entity. And that's one of the issues, because if the superintendent of Smith School decided that they're going to do something else to the nursery, then that's the end of it. So if you have a site that is actually, if we find a site, or if Wayne identifies potential sites that are coming up that we can actually, the president wants to don't give it to the city, then when you write in that conservation restriction as to what the land is going to be used for, that's it. It can never be changed, nothing can, no one can ever alter it. I'm not saying that's going to happen in Smith Boat, but I'm just saying that I think it's a good place to do that, but I'm always afraid of the unknown.
Is it possible to craft a lease with Smith Boat so that we have a little bit more control of?
Or some agreement with the trustees or something like that? Because it has its own like weird governing.
That's a possibility, it could be looked at.
We can, explore both options, figure out how to make Smith Boat one work better, and then looking at municipal properties that might work too.
And I think after talking to the instructor, I used to be a vocational high school instructor, I think what it would take to, just because there's more than one group, operating here, it probably would take one person to kind of be a coordinator, could be like one of us to, be the liaison between, Smith and Smith Folk and your office and our interests, to have somebody, a commissioner who's sub-job or whatever you want to call it, would be the liaison, nursery liaison or something. So we could have control of what gets planted and what system is used and what kind of things. Volunteer, I just think it would make it go a little more smoothly. And, hopefully the ball wouldn't get dropped.
Okay.
Just what I learned, because I'm buying bare root stock for my nursery right now, is that everything's really locked up. That I think a lot of the bare root growers are getting a lot of demand right now. So they dig in November and February. So if they, obviously, when they do their orders, so we're planning planning 2 springs out for like a successful nursery. But from what I gather, there's a lot of like competition in the tree market right now. So
you're creating a nursery in Holyoke?
Oh yeah.
And how big? How many acres?
400 trees. 400 trees, it's like 2/3 of an acre, more or less.
400? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
All you're gonna
grow bags. Grow bags.
But they're gonna be all planted at the same time, or
we're gonna
staggering.
Try to stagger it. Mm-hmm. It all depends on what we get and when we get it, I think that's the limiting factor, is when we get the stuff.
And what size do we envision? What's your ideal amount of land, Jay, for what you think we need?
An acre or less.
That gives us a lot of options, doesn't it? I feel like that gives us some. I think we should be really strategic about getting it in a place where it can be accessed so the trees can be cared for. Because there's a lot of land out there in the western part of the city that, I think Wayne would be more than happy to, hand off to somebody else for ongoing care, but it's just not accessible. It's not high quality land either. So I think we want to be really careful about what we take.
I think it's a good midterm, year and a half out project to plan for and do successful.
Yeah. I definitely think it's a goal we should shoot for. Okay, anything else about the nursery?
I just had one other, so the instructor is willing to dig some of them by hand, not those huge ones, but it doesn't sound like, because he'll teach ball and burlap or whatever, but it doesn't seem like we want to move on that right now, right, for the fall.
On what?
On digging stuff out of there.
The bigger trees?
And using it. Well, he thought there was some, I didn't walk the, you may know probably know more than, it was just, I kind of let it open-ended that I was going to get back to him. So he just needs to know, am I going to be doing a week of digging up trees by hand? The bigger ones, his suggestion was to see if we could, like, get a tree mover, you know, to spade them, and his thought was to put them on Burt's Pit Road by the community gardens up there where they took all those trees out.
Or where the,
The dog walk.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the sugar maples.
Actually, there was a request to plant from Barbara Hobson, who was...
DCR's, not DCR, MDAR.
And, correct, yes, MDAR's person responsible for all that ag land. There was a request from her through Tim Smith to actually plant 10 red maples there. I have it because they want to plant it in the public right away. But I haven't heard anything about the planting that's going on. Maybe that could be something they could do with those trees. Mm-hmm. Whatever they plant there is not really salt tolerant, so that's one problem, just because there's a lot of salt there. That is a
possibility.
That's a possibility, yeah. Might be good maybe for us to take a little walk over there to kind of see what's actually in there. And, you know, I'd hate to...
Would that be okay? Would Rich and Jay be able to go and walk through the
Oh, totally. You can go anytime. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it doesn't, anybody can walk in there. All
right.
I mean, just climb in there.
If you guys go, I'd love to join you, just because I'm curious.
Can I come as well, please?
What?
Do you mind if I come as well?
No, I don't mind.
So, he also thought there could be a drip system put in there, possibly, you know, that they could install, you know, if we had, they don't have the money to buy it, but if some way we got drippers, like, his students could put it up. And the maintenance over the summer, that was the only thing. Let me see if there's one out there. So, I think that's it. That was the only, November 9th to the 13th was the week that he had, was the best for him to do planting with his students. So that might work out because there may be leftovers, right? But my assumption is I should tell him not to hand dig those trees, whatever he thinks he could, the small ones.
Their recommendation would be to root prune.
That was the other conversation we had. I said, well, maybe we could just root prune them and then, okay, so.
I thought those were on the fall hazard list, though. Some of those are on the fall hazard list, right?
Of digging?
Yeah.
I'd have to look it up.
Those are huge ones, but I think some of those are on the fall hazard list.
Yeah, I'd have to look it up, to be honest with you. And he thought some of those were in grow bags, but they're probably not in the grow bag anymore.
They are, and I would throw them away.
What's that?
It'd be interesting. It might be a good experiment.
Excavate what it looks like.
I think maybe the ginkgos might be some of the smaller trees, everything we gave them was all bare root, unless they put them in grow bags. Because once you gave them the bare root stock, the students planted them high at the time. I didn't go over there and inspect everything.
Right.
I have one more item in business, so I'm going to move us off this topic before we do to-dos. And that is that I have been in communication with a fellow named Felix Lufkin, who runs a nonprofit organization. I just put it in quotes because it's not like it's a 501c3. It's Felix's baby, called Help Yourself, which some of you may be familiar with, has really pushed the idea of planting edible plants, not just throughout Northampton, but the broader Pioneer Valley, and have made a big effort maybe a couple of years ago to get permission from the city to plant in some sites. One they call Frogtown, which is this area between, it's the area of the bike path between Pleasant Street and the Maplewood Shoppers parking lot. And I think that they have I think that they have done some interesting plantings. They tend to plant and then are not as good at upkeep. So there's a lot of things that have gone into disarray. And the reason why Felix came up was because when we were doing our tour the other day, the four of us, we identified a spot along Old South, where Old South sort of meets Cons, where there potentially could be some great large shade tree plantings. And upon closer look, we realized that there were all these little tiny plantings there. And it turns out, help yourself, planted there. It's not actually along the bike path, though. So I don't know if they got permission from Wayne to do that, or if they just sort of, you know, went a little further than I don't know the ins and outs of it. Nevertheless, we approached Felix and said, hey, listen, we've identified this as potentially a really great place for shade trees. And he was polite but concerned because he had just done some plantings there. And he, you know, he's Felix is a very knowledgeable guy, very well-intentioned, real shaker and mover. But he sees, in my view, he sees the world through a fairly narrow lens. And that is, a plant is good if it's edible. And that is like, that should be our charge, is to plant as much edible plantings as we can, you know, to prepare for a world of food insecurity in the future. And as someone who found a group in Northampton, I appreciate that perspective. On the other hand, I choose, when it comes to like an urban setting, to have a broader lens at what constitutes a valuable plant and a beneficial plant. And so what I said is, hey, listen, you know, we're not going to plant anything immediately. We had identified it as a place where we were going to do planting for our training last Saturday, but we said ixnay on that. Come to a meeting of the Public Shade Tree Commission and we'll have a conversation. Because I personally think that if he is, I'd like to better understand who he's coordinating with when it comes to the plantings they're doing, because it actually turns out that a number of those plantings were like orchard trees and just like a whole variety of things, some understory, some larger, but no shade trees. And so I'd like to understand a little bit the chain of command there, and I'd also love to, now that we exist, to have a conversation so that we're not working at cross purposes, but we're actually working, you know, in the same direction for some of the same goals. So, you know, with your permission, I'd like to invite him to come and actually be on the agenda of the next, it doesn't actually even have to be the next, a future Public Shade Tree Commission meeting. Okay.
I like that idea, sounds good.
Yeah, all right. Any other thoughts? Did I sum it up pretty well? Okay.
Yeah, he's got a fair number of volunteers that he works with, so they're able to get things done. They've been doing these for years, actually.
They're better at the planting part than the maintenance part.
Well, they are able to raise some funds. They get like a whole bunch of bare roots, so they'll get like 60 Concord grape vines, and they'll put them out all along all the chain link fences along the bikeway, and hope that they'll cover them. And maybe they will.
And take the fence down.
That may not be part of the plan.
One of the things that we have encountered, unfortunately, is that they, as Lily alluded to, they have difficulty maintaining some of these plantings after the fact. Yeah. And so there becomes this huge interference with people that actually use the bike path. And there were a bunch of plants that inadvertently got destroyed on the bike path between Veterans Field and the Roundhouse parking lot because it was so overgrown. Bikers were complaining that the grass and weeds were. People were riding their bikes and they're hitting them. Mm-hmm. So we went and mowed it, and next thing you know, we chopped up their plants.
Yeah. Right.
So those are the kind of things that I think would be, that's why they really, the process that happened is that Felix actually put out an email to Wayne, and then Wayne forwarded it to the individuals who, the different individuals who are responsible for parts of the bike path system. Mm-hmm. And we all said, okay, that's fine, but as long as you promise to maintain the plantings, basically in perpetuity. So that's kind of how that all started. And then there really, I don't think, has been any follow-up on the city side to actually monitor what he's been doing. And, you know, we know where he's planting, but actually follow up and say, you know, there's an issue here. Can you address this? If you don't address it, we're going to have to go and mow it. Those are the kind of conversation the follow-up hasn't happened.
Right.
And that's what That's how that incident happened on a bike path.
And so where he planted at the corner of, I guess it's like Hampton Terrace? Is that right? Hampton?
He's talking about right up there, right?
Hampton Avenue.
Hampton Avenue and Old South Street?
Near the brewery.
Yeah, near the brewery, but at that very corner, and it's actually a very important sightline corner.
Yeah, I saw him like a few weeks ago.
I think it was springtime, maybe. Maybe it was more recent than that. But anyway, so Rich was, can you see it from here?
Yeah, that's property that belongs to the Parking Commission. So that is not property in the public right of way, I don't believe, because it's on the backside of the sidewalk.
What does that mean, the car?
Okay, so the Parking Commission, we're a group of folks similar to the Board of Public Works, to the Conservation Commission, that used to, I call it Parking Commission, they don't exist anymore. I don't know why, but they basically are, the parking department maintains all the city parking lots. And the city's tax collector is the responsible party for the maintenance of the parking. They're responsible for taking the fees from the parking, the maintenance is responsible for David Pomeroy, who's the Director of Central Services. So they disbanded the Parking Commission, and they took the duties and divided them up amongst different departments in the city.
So no one?
Yeah.
Does that explain why all the city wars are getting girdled, because, you know, no one's in that parking lot, because no one's pulling up?
I mean, they maintain them to the best of their ability with the limited staff that they have, but.
And they being Central Services?
Central Services, yeah.
I think we should bring Central Services in.
Yeah, it sounds like they need to come in, yeah.
So DPW doesn't need to go in there, that's not your.
No, we'll go in there, like, for example, all the dead trees, we cut all the trees down. We plant the trees for them, we also patch all their potholes. So there's this, you know, symbiosis, but there's not really any, like, active oversight. There is oversight, but it's not, it's more geared towards.
Is it reactive?
It's more geared to parking cars, collecting money and revenue streams, because that's kind of the mantra from about 10 years ago, because of the, you know, parking action, parking revenue in the city pays for a lot of general fund positions and things. So that's, it's been more geared to that.
So do you suspect that Help Yourself connected with Central Services?
No, I think they connected with Wayne. They connected with Wayne, and Wayne directed them to either David Pomeranz or to.
So maybe in advance of Felix coming, I should just check in with Wayne?
Yeah.
Okay.
He'll give you because there is a link on the planning department's webpage, you know, it says Adopt a Trail, Adopt a Bike Trail. So they have this Adopt a Trail program, and I think that Felix's group adopted part of this. This is called the Nagel Walkway over here.
Okay.
Which actually doesn't belong to planning, it belongs to the Recreation Commission. Don't ask me, this is how they divide, I'm like the history book, but.
Deeper and deeper.
So there's all these little different groups that you have to communicate with. So you send out this big broad spectrum email, and if everybody agrees to it, then you can go ahead and do it. You know, the DPW is responsible for the Francis B. Ryan part of the bikeway, which starts at Stop and Shop and goes to Bridge Road.
All right.
So it's just all these little bits and pieces. So as things are getting built, and I had this conversation with Wayne prior to meeting with Jay, is that we do a really great job of snatching a property and building things on it, and then we just forget about the maintenance. We just, who's gonna take care of it, you know, and that's indicative of the bike trail. It goes from the, basically Smith College's powerhouse out to East Hampton. We are only able to maintain it by mowing with a large sidearm mower, and they use volunteers to do the rest. That's not really an effective way of doing it, so we're going with a different plan.
Yeah, and East Hampton is like.
Yep, so it's really kind of a hodgepodge administrative problem.
Yeah.
More senior workers.
All right.
If they still had that program, that'd be great.
I know, right?
Okay. All righty, that was my only other business. Marilyn, to do, summary of our.
Okay, if I missed anything, let me know, this is what I captured.
And will you dump all this onto the spreadsheet?
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
Okay, so Lily is going to extend the survey to September 25th. Is going to connect with Andy regarding creating a link to the Google map with language for both the inventory and the planting. And is going to get letters of support from Terry Page and the Ward 3 Association. That sort of group, yeah. And is going to walk with Jay and Rich to view those trees that Jen referred to.
And
is going to check in with Wayne about the central services question and invite Felix to a meeting regarding help yourself and edible plants. Rich, going to find out about the fine. Does that go to the general fund or to the tree fund? Rich is going to get first aid kits, radios, and safety vests. Jay and Rich are looking at other potential nursery sites. And I'm trying to do this by name, so bear with me here. Jen is going to follow up with the Voc students regarding their help with planting. They're available in November. And Jen is also going to, Jen and Rob, I know you guys are working together on this, pulling together the information packets, the release forms, and the name tags. They're going to be meeting sometime in the next week regarding the plantings. And Jen is going to get the standard information to Rich for elimination. Okay. I've got Andrew working on the budget and the narrative for the next meeting. And for the 9/28 meeting, the climate meeting, who's going to that?
Jay and I.
Did I miss anything?
The 21st, I think, is Monday. I'm meeting with the Key Club in Virgo about the students to help in the planting volunteers.
Oh, sorry. Was that something different than?
That is different than that. That's Northampton High. The Voc is Smith Voc. It's a different school.
Okay. What is it called again?
The Key Club.
Oh, Key Club. At Smith?
No, that's at Northampton High.
Oh, Northampton High, okay.
Andy and Rich are going to try to have the Google tree map updated by the end of this week, did you say, Rich?
Andy's going to try to see if he can migrate that information. Yes. Add it to the spreadsheet, because right now it's in a separate layer at the moment. And then I'm just going to continue to plug away at adjusting sites.
Okay.
Start with all stakes
for
the
first part.
Yeah. Okay.
Cool.
Okay, I'll
just
use to the Google.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, and I'm also going to add the added by column, so that if anybody has something else, so we can keep track of who adds things.
Yep.
But as far as adding things from meetings, I'll
we'll assume it's you.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Do we have a motion to adjourn this meeting?
Mm-hmm.
Second.
I second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Meeting's adjourned. Thanks, everybody.